Thank you. Bible to Malachi 3, and I'm going to say them several times. Malachi 3, and then we're going to turn quickly to 3 John, the second chapter, and then Isaiah 62. And I'll give you all of the scriptures, but again, it's Malachi, the third chapter, 3 John 2, and Isaiah 62. I don't know about you, I just feel blessed this morning. I'm just going to ask that you pray with me. I'm just tired this morning, but I'm good tired. And let me tell you why. On Thursday night, I had the opportunity to do a photo shoot with Sister Judge Penny Brown Reynolds. And we'll give you more information about that coming up for our upcoming conference. And then on Friday, we had to see about Sister Adrienne Williams because she sees about everyone. Had to support her, and I'm just so thankful that she's here this morning. But at a homeboy celebration, we still had a blessed time because her father lived a blessed life. And then on noon on Saturday, we were just glad to be a part of a blessing. It was a luncheon to celebrate life. Someone that had gotten diagnosed with an illness, and the devil is just mad because a year later we were celebrating at a luncheon, talking about life. Such a beautiful thing. And then Saturday evening, 6 o'clock at a wedding. So God is so good. No matter where you are, circumstance, he's still good. And he still blesses us. So Malachi, the third chapter. We're going to start at the 7th and the 8th. Verse, and then we're going to skip down to the 13th and the 14th verses.
All right.
Malachi 3. Even from the days of your fathers, you have gone away from my ordinances and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts. But ye say, wherein shall we return? Will a man rob God?
Yes.
Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have ye robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. And then we're going to skip down to 13 and 14. Your words have been stout against me, saith the Lord. Yet ye say, what have we spoken so much against thee? Ye have said, it is vain to serve God. And what profit is it that we have kept his ordinance, and that we have walked mournfully before the Lord of hosts? And then 3 John, the second chapter, and just the second verse. And it reads 3 John 2 and 2. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper,
yes,
and be in health, even as thy soul prospers.
Right.
And then Isaiah 62, we're going to read 1 through 5, and then the 12th verse. Isaiah 62, 1 through 5. And it reads, for Zion's sake will I not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest, until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. And the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory, and thou shalt be called by a new name.
That's right.
With the mouth of the Lord shall name. Thou shalt also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. Thou shalt no more be termed forsaken, neither shall thy land any more be termed desolate. But thou shalt be called Hephzibah, and thy land Beulah, for the Lord delighteth in thee, and thy land shall be married. For as a young man marrieth a virgin, so shall thy sons marry thee. And as the bridegroom rejoiceth over the bride, so shall thy God rejoice over thee. And then we're going to skip down to the 12th verse. And they shall call them the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And thou shalt be called sought out, a city not forsaken. And for a subject, I'm trying to get a blessing to you. The message today is about God's provision, his protection, and simply how he wants to bless us. How many of you feel blessed by God? How many of you, even though you of other blessings. It's a blessing just to breathe. It is a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. It's a blessing to be saved. It's a blessing to know that you are blessed. Some folks don't realize just how blessed they are. How do I know? Some people complain about what others are thankful for.
That's right.
I remember I had a friend that was so upset because she had to move down to a 5-bedroom home. And she was upset because it wasn't in a certain neighborhood anymore. Now, mind you, the 5-bedroom was fabulous, but it was not where she wanted to be in when other people around her were losing their homes. Didn't know how blessed she was.
That's right.
I know some folks complain about their children not getting a certain scholarship when some parents have to visit their children in jail. Just don't know how blessed we are. Pastor Gerard told us last week, some folks complain about having to get up early and drive through traffic to get to work when other folks don't have a job and cannot provide for their family. We don't know how blessed we are. And whether you know it or not, our complaining, which translates to ungratefulness, our attitude blocks that other blessing from coming our way. How can God bless you with greater things when you're not happy with what you already have? I'm so grateful to be able to use my hands instead of complaining about the work I have to do with them. I'm so glad to be able to tap my feet when others don't have feet or feeling in their feet. I'm so glad to be able to sit in traffic in my car because I have one. So grateful to be able to visit the hospital instead of being in the hospital. Count your many blessings. Name them one by one. Count them. See what the Lord has done. The problem is we are counting what we have done rather than what the Lord has done. You really don't mean to be disrespectful. You just don't realize that the Lord has blessed you. See, blessed means to ask of God, the bestower of divine favor. Divine favor. God bestows the divine favor. That's when you know you're blessed. You've been wondering why they chose you over others. It was the bestower of divine favor. You wonder why your name is mentioned more in a room than others? It's the bestowal of divine favor. You wonder why God spared you? It is the bestowal of divine favor. Why are you driving and going around when others and thriving when others are sinking? It is the bestowal of divine favor. You see, God can't bless what's not in his will. God can't bless which goes against his word. God can't bless sin. What sin does is block the blessed and make it less. Less than what God had planned for your life. Less than what you deserve because of the blood of Jesus. There are those that are living the blessed life, living hope, trusting God, waiting on a change. And then there are those that are living the less life.
Yes.
He cannot bless dishonesty. He can't bless wrongful acts. But when we ask of God the bestowal of divine favor, we are blessed. God is trying to get a blessing to you. But first we have to clean up some things and allow God's divine favor to come into our lives. He can't bless your sleeping arrangements if it's not marriage according to his plan. He can't bless you to the next level if you're praising 1 minute and cursing the next. He can't bestow his divine favor on someone that thinks that they are bigger than God. God doesn't just want to bless us. He wants to shower us with blessings. You see, from a distance, blessed and less look alike. Blessed and less both go to the same church. Blessed and less praise the Lord. Blessed and less sometimes dress alike. Blessed and less can drive the same car, live in the same kind of house, have the same trials. But the big difference, and the beautiful difference, and the bountiful difference, is that blessed gives God the glory for everything in his life. trust is in the Lord.
Amen.
And blessed has favor.
That's right. Amen.
Let's look at less. Less may have more.
All right.
But more doesn't give you sleep at night. More doesn't comfort your soul.
That's right.
Doesn't bring your children in. Doesn't make you loyal to God. I'd rather be blessed.
Amen.
And have less.
Amen.
And trust God and my confidence be in God than be less and have more and trust myself.
Amen.
Donald Trump. We just need to stop and take an inventory of our lives. for the blood of Jesus that he bestowed upon us. So can the righteous people in this room shout out?
Amen.
Today I have given you three scriptural references to prove that God not only has blessed, but he wants to continue to bless you. It is his will and it is his desire for you as Christians to live a blessed life. It's meant for you. I want you to get that in your spirit, to live a blessed life. He's trying to get a blessing to you. Who better to show his glory than his children? I don't know about you, but when my children were young, when they stepped out of the house, they had to look like my children. Everything had to be in place. Still is, Alicia. Looking like they had a mother and a father that cared about them. They looked maintained. They had to act like they had good sense. Because their parents invested everything in them to make sure they lived a blessed life. Well, your heavenly Father has invested his very best, called Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins. And through the shed blood of Jesus, we were not only saved so that we wouldn't go to hell, but we were saved that we wouldn't have to go through hell on earth. Parents invest so much in their children so that we will be blessed. And if we walk around in need, it's a reflection of our Father, not supplying what we need. Again, I remember growing up, and our parents were very prideful. And especially my mother, she had this thing that if you went to someone's house, you couldn't ask for anything to eat. And even if it was offered, you had to politely say no. My mother had this pride that we didn't appreciate sometimes. But we had to maintain it because we represented her. But it was understood. And so one day we went to Miss Sarah's house, who lived right around the street. And she said to us, "I know your mother don't let you eat at other folks' house. But I got some food over there on the stove. Dinner over the stove, and y'all can go over there. I made some homemade cakes and pies and a big dinner over there." And she said the word that I just cannot resist. I had my mother's picture in my face, but she said, "I got some barbecue ribs for you." And I said, "Sorry, Mama, I'll take the beef. We're gonna eat these ribs."
Yeah.
and be more blessed than if I didn't give anything. The tithers will tell you that it is more the most liberating and blessed feeling to deposit your treasure in God's storehouse. I've been a tither for most of my life, and I've been blessed. Doesn't mean I've never been broke, but I've always been blessed. And just in the nick of time, not just one time, but every time, God came through. And then I learned to not only tithe my finances, but my time and my talent. And God has returned more than enough to me. And above my time and my talent, I've learned to give offerings. Anybody know what I'm talking about? The word is clear on how God wants to bless you. God said, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me. Somebody say, prove me. Prove me now, he will, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. God said, I will open you, not just your purse, not just your wallet, not just your bank account, but God said, I will open you. Meaning every area in my life that the devil has tried to block or close, God said, I will open you the windows of heaven. Then he said, I will pour you. No matter where you go, God is going to give you favor. People will know your name. He will use you for his glory. Pour you out a blessing that you will not have room enough to receive. Dream small, small room. Dream big, big room. And even in a big room, God said you still won't have room enough to receive it. You see, tithers think different. They think God first, and then everything else will fall into place. They are kingdom minded. They think about God. You're using me to get somebody saved, get somebody off of the streets. God, you bless me, and I want to be faithful and help others. They're kingdom minded. Tithers think, I know what it takes to run my house. I know it takes way more to run God's house. We tell you often, we pastors don't look at tithe records. We don't know who gives what. But we do know through action who some of the tithers are. Because they have a special interest in their investment. And they want to see the church run well and doing well. Not through complaining, but through working and giving. Can all the workers say amen? And then he gives you an additional promise. I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. The devourer, God likened to locusts. You build a garden, and before you can pick the crop, the locusts come and eat. But God said, I will protect them and keep their land from becoming desolate. The blessings God bestows on the one who gives abundantly to do God's work is not just money. God blesses everything you put your hand to. God sends the rain at the proper time and the sun, and your crop grows abundantly. Blessings. And God is trying to get a blessing to you, but you gotta trust him. Then in the next part of Malachi, he says, your words have been stout against me, saith the Lord. Yet ye say, what have we spoken so much against thee? You have said it is vain to serve God. And what profit is it that we have kept his ordinance and that we walk mournfully before the Lord of hosts? You see, the book of Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. Amen. The last warning from a prophet until 400 years later. There is silence for 400 years. And the next voice is that of John the Baptist crying in the wilderness. Malachi is telling the children of Israel and warning them again. God has brought you out of Babylon. He has allowed you return to the promised land. He has allowed you to rebuild the temple. He has preserved you as a people and as a nation. Yet you have spoken against me, and you even went as far as to say, it is not necessary to serve God or keep his word or go to the house of worship. How can their hearts be hardened against the same
delivered them. The same God that protected them. The same God that preserved them when their forefathers were slaves. The same God that gave them songs in the midst of some of the greatest trials that they were going through. Does it sound familiar? Swing low, sweet chariot. The same God that sent prophets to comfort them and tell them God's plan. How could they turn their backs on God when they were the people that crossed the Red Sea on dry land, fought wars with sometimes the sound of instruments, and won? Saw God send fire from heaven, killed giants with a slingshot, had a temple with the Ark of a Covenant. How could they just sit at home and not serve God? Amen. The same way we do. Amen. The same way we speak against, maybe not in words, but in our action. The same way we walk away from our values, from the Word of God. The same way we compromise and make excuses. But God said, I'm trying to get a blessing to you. So two areas we've cursed ourselves. In the tithes, and then speaking against God, His church, and His ordinances. And yet God still said, I want to bless you. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. How do you know He still wants to bless us? Because in the next scripture that I gave you, God said, I wish above all things. Doesn't that sum up God's desire for our life? He said, I wish above all things that you prosper, be in good health, even as your soul prospers. And then he backs it up with Jeremiah 29. For I know the plans I have for you. Yes. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Yes. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Yes. Prosper. What does prosper mean? A successful, flourishing, or thriving condition. Not just in finances, but in every area of your life. I'm going to give you more scripture to prove that God is trying to get a blessing to you. We don't like to think of prosperity in the church because of all the prosperity preaching of the 80s and the 90s. Some people got hurt by giving but never receiving.
Yes.
It just seemed like the people that got it were the people at the top and nobody else got the blessing. But we need to talk about it. We need to open up our hearts to receive God's blessing. Why? Because our children think that they can only get it through music or reality shows or through sports or illegal manners. But it is God who gives us the power to get wealth. It is God. We don't like to think on the fact that it is well with God that we live a prosperous life. But it is. Not only is it well with God, it is His desire. And He backs it up with His word.
Yeah.
You know why it's well with God? Because God can trust you enough to know that when He blesses you, and because He has blessed you, you're going to use it for His glory.
Right.
You're going to lift up the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
You will use it to bless others. Yeah. Amen?
Yeah.
Couple of scriptures. Deuteronomy 8 and 18. You don't have to turn. I'm going to read quickly. You shall remember the Lord your God. For it is He who gives you power to get wealth, that He may confirm His covenant that He swore to your fathers, as it is this day. Philippians 4:19, and my God will supply every need of yours according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Psalm 128:2, you shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands, you shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. 2 Corinthians 9:8, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. Joshua 1:9, have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed. Dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Psalm 1:3, He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that He does, He prospers. And then the last one, 2 Corinthians 8:9. For you know the grace of writes your glorious future in Isaiah 62. Our last scripture reference, Isaiah 62, proclaims not only our future, but God's desire for our life.
Amen.
Somebody may be feeling like, God, will it ever be my turn?
Yeah, right.
Will I ever live that I don't have to worry about things coming together? I want you to get what the true blessing is. The blessing is not having money. The blessing is knowing the source. The blessing is not being able to buy what you want when you want it, but the blessing is knowing that I was once young and now I'm old. And I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. The blessing is not being glad that I made it this month. The blessing is knowing that God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. The blessing, if you don't get it by now, is knowing. Knowing what? If God is for me, who can be against me? The blessing is knowing that he is. Not the job, not the endowment, not the wheel left behind, not the grant, not the scholarship, not the raise, not the bonus, not the welfare check, not the unemployment check, not the allowance, not the check in the mail, but the blessing is in knowing that he is your job.
About
giving to the Lord. And some say that was Old Testament, but if you cross-reference, it's New Testament. But that doesn't matter. And what I want to tell you is that tithing came about even before the law.
Amen.
It came about. And now you want to say that we don't have to do that, but the law said thou shalt not kill. And you don't kill, just try to kill, you're going to jail. But here we are, in bondage, with giving back to God. To give back, not because God is in need, but because he just want to test your obedience. He said, prove me. Herewith, saith the Lord. Can I just tell you this too? From this church, from this pulpit, we've never begged for money. We've never asked you for money. But we do ask you to tithe. Because it will bless you. And that, as pastors, we want you to get the blessing. Oh yeah, we want to keep the air on. We want to keep all the bills paid. We want to be prosperous. We want you to be blessed. Don't block your blessing anymore. Isaiah 62. For Zion's sake, I will not hold my peace. And for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest. Says the Lord assures them that he will not rest until Jerusalem is restored in a shining righteousness.
Yes.
Then the second verse, and the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory. It is one thing for folks to call you blessed and to give you a new name, but God said you will be called by a new name out of my mouth. And then the third verse. Thou shalt also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. The idea is not that our inheritance is just in the Lord, but his inheritance is also in us. We often have a superficial understanding of how precious we are to God. And here comes our new name. Thou shalt no more be termed forsaken. Say, I am not forsaken.
I am not forsaken.
Neither shall thy land anymore be termed desolate. My land is not desolate.
My land is not desolate.
But thou shalt be called Hephzibah. Say, I am Hephzibah.
I am Hephzibah.
And thy land Beulah.
My land
For the Lord delighted in thee. And thy land shall be married. You will no longer be forsaken Jerusalem. Knew the experience of war and defeat and desolation. God's people knew what it was like to feel forsaken and desolate. Some folks have settled in on poverty, on defeat, on being forsaken, and accepted that as their last name. I am forsaken, I am desolate, I am defeated, settled in on living a life that you would never prosper. But God said, no, I have a new name for you. And then the last one, the 12th, and they shall call them the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And thou shalt be called sought out, a city not forsaken. Everyone will know that you are kept by God.
That's right.
He wants to bless you. He's trying to get a blessing to you. If you trust the words spoken over your life today, and if you know that your Redeemer lives, if you know that you will come out of this cycle, if you believe you are a holy people, if you believe that your name is Hephzibah, that you are Beulah, then give God glory. Pray that prayer today. because I believe that God's going to create many billionaires in this church. Come out of the aisle and come down front, and we'll lead you to Christ.